हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, ब्रेन विद नॉलेज, हैंड्स विद बुक्स, हार्ट्स विद लव, थॉट्स विद पीस आर एनफ टू चेंज दिस वर्ल्ड. विद दिस थॉट आई एम गोइंग टू स्टार्ट माय क्लास. आई होप यू ऑल स्पेंड मोर टाइम इन स्टडीज, पे क्लोज अटेंशन टू द स्टडीज एंड कंप्लीट द होमवर्क प्रॉपरली, फिनिश द लेसन्स ऑफ द डे ऑन द सेम डे. टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू टीच द कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ द प्रीवियस क्लास. Lesson 1, Object Oriented Programming Language, Part 3. In my previous video, already you learned about introduction of Object Oriented Programming Language, evolution of software, programming paradigms. In this video, I am going to teach about basic concepts of Object Oriented Programming Language and advantages and disadvantages of Object Oriented Programming Language. Before we get into the new topic, we can recall what you learned in the previous class. First one is, what is paradigm? Paradigm means organizing principle of a program. It is an approach to programming. The another meaning of paradigm is a way of thinking or doing things. The another one is object-oriented programming. Object-oriented programming means the stress is put on data rather than the function. The data is restricted to be used in a specific program area. It follows bottom-up programming approach. Next one is, what is procedural or modular programming? Procedural oriented programming means the stress is put on the function rather than the data. It allows data to flow freely throughout the program. It follows top-down programming approach. Next one is, what is a class? A class is a template of objects. A class is a template or blueprint representing a group of objects that share common properties and relationships. Next one is, what is an object? An object is an actual entity which is an instance of a class. This is what we learned in the previous class. Now let's enter into the new topic. In this lesson, the next topic is basic concepts of object-oriented programming language. There are four basic concepts are there. First one is data abstraction. Next one is inheritance. Next one is polymorphism. And last one is encapsulation. Now we will see briefly one by one. First we will see about data abstraction. In real life situation, you might have noticed that we need not required to know the details of the technologies to operate the system. For example, you know a digital camera and you want to capture a photograph. The system simply provides a number of buttons and switches to control the operations needed to take the photograph. In fact, these buttons make the system easy so that anybody can operate the camera, though he may not know the technology. Have you ever thought what changes would take place in the internal part of the chip? How does the camera manage to take the photograph just by clicking the button? You may not be able to answer such questions because you are unaware of technology used inside the camera. So, you may say that we use only the essential features of the camera to take photograph without knowing the internal mechanism. It may be noted that the abstraction of an object depends upon the area of applications. So what is the data abstraction? Data abstraction is the act of representing the essential features without knowing the background details. It is always relative to the purpose of user. So this is about data abstraction. This is a first basic concept of the object-oriented programming language. Now let's see about encapsulation. Recall that the characteristics and behavior together make an object in the programming language. Characteristics are represented through data and behavior through functions. Already we know characteristics are represented through data. Data is also known as variables, and behavior is represented through code. Code means methods. Methods are also known as functions. So class is variables and methods, and encapsulation is data and code. So encapsulation is a way of combining both data and the functions that operate on the data under a single unit. So it's also called as member functions or member methods. So the data cannot be accessed directly. If you want to read a data item in an object, you call a method or member function in the object to do it. The data is hidden, so it is safe from accidental alteration. Data and its function are said to be encapsulated into a single entity. Thus, we can say that the data is kept hidden, which cannot be accessed directly outside the object, although it is available in the same program. An illustration of encapsulation is given, depicting how the data can be accessed through functions. So, what is the encapsulation? The system of wrapping data and functions into a single unit is known as encapsulation. The system of wrapping data means variables and functions means methods into a single unit, that is called class, is known as encapsulation. This is about encapsulation. Now let's see about inheritance. You might have studied the term heredity in biology, which means the transmission of genetically based characteristics from parents to the offsprings. We inherit thousands of characters from parents who in turn had inherited those from their parents and so on. Similarly, the object of a class acquires some properties from the objects of another class. This is possible by deriving a new class from the existing class. The new class will have combined features of both the classes. The class that gets inherited to another class is known as base class or super class. The class that inherits from a base class is known as derived class or subclass or target. Let us take an example of a class animal, which can broadly be classified as carnivorous, herbivorous and omnivorous. So you will find that some of the characteristics or properties of the class animal will be inherited by the class carnivorous and herbivorous and omnivorous. Let us see another example. This is our old example of cars. The class car inherits some of the properties from the class automobiles. This class will inherit some of the properties from the class automobiles, which inherits some of the properties from the another class vehicles. So this class inherits the properties from the automobiles and automobiles inherits the properties from the vehicles. The capability to pass down properties is the powerful one. It all allows to describe things in an economical way. So see here, there are two classes are here, bus and car. These two classes inherits the properties from the automobiles, and automobiles are inherits the properties from the vehicle. Likewise, cart and rickshaw inherits the properties from the manually pulled, and manually pulled inherits the properties from the vehicles. So vehicle is a base class and automobiles manually pulled is a derived class, and cars, bus and derived class of the automobiles, rickshaw and cart is a derived class of the manually pulled. So vehicle is a base class, these all derived classes. Another name of base class is super class. Base class also known as parent class. So the another name of base class is super class and parent class. Derived class are also known as subclass and child class. Now let's see what is an inheritance. The term inheritance means to link and share some common properties of one class with the other class. See here, it will share some common properties from one class to another class. So this is about inheritance, and this can be done by extending the object of one class into another class and using through it. So what is a base class? A base class is a super class or parent class from which another class inherits properties. And what is a subclass? Its inheriting class is called subclass. It's also known as derived class. The another name of subclass is child class. So base class also known as super class and parent class, and subclass is also known as child class or derived class. So this is about inheritance. Now let's see about polymorphism. You know that a single word can have many meanings. Similarly, an operation may show entirely different behavior for different set of data and environment. Let us take an example of English word duck. The word duck defines a water bird with a broad bill, short legs and webbed feet various. The same word duck in a cricket match means a batsman who got out with no score. With the reference of above examples, you can notice that the same word duck is used for two different purposes. Similarly, you can find many such examples in real life situations. The function overloading is a process to create a member of functions, methods with the same name but with different parameters that match up the method's name to execute the program. So what is a polymorphism? The term polymorphism defines as the process of using a function or method for more than one purpose. Let's see another examples. See here, in this method there are three functions are here. One is Maruti, Alto, Brazo. These three functions having the same properties, that is same functions, behaviors, that is speed. So according to the characteristics of the car, the speed will be different. For example, Maruti speed is 60 km, Alto speed is 70 km, Brazo speed is 80 km, but the behavior is same. What is the behavior? The speed is a behavior. This behavior is same for all the functions. These all functions comes under the one class, that is car. Okay, so car having different functions, but these functions having common properties, that is speed. Likewise here also, shape is a class. This class having some common same functions, that is area, but according to the behavior. Okay, circle formula is pi r squared. So to find out the area, we need only one property, that is radius. To find out the area of the triangle, we need only one property, that is side. And to find out the area of the rectangle, we need two properties, that is length and breadth. So it is the process of using function or method for more than one purpose. The term function overloading is defined as it has the same function name with different parameters. Same function name, that is area. These three having same function name, that is area, but it's having different parameters. Circle area is area having only one parameter, that is radius. Triangle also having only one parameter, that is side. And rectangle having two parameters, that is length and breadth. So the term function overloading is defined as it has the same function name with different parameters. So what is a polymorphism? The term polymorphism defines as the process of using a function or method for more than one purpose. So this is about polymorphism. Now let's see the advantages and disadvantages of object-oriented programming language. First we will see the advantages. Through inheritance, we can eliminate code and extend the use of existing classes. Already we know in inheritance, the base class and derived classes are there. Derived classes can inherit the properties from the base class. So we can eliminate code and extend the use of existing classes. So this is the first advantage. Second one is reusability. What is reusability? Reusability is a mechanism which facilitates you to reuse the fields and methods of existing class when you create a new class. You can use the same fields and methods already defined in the previous class. So this is reusability. Next one is easy to understand. And next one is models the real world well. And next one is the principle of data hiding helps the programmer to build secure programs. It means data hiding not mean the security technique used for protecting computer databases, though the user can use the private data but not by accident. The principle of data hiding helps the programmer to build secure programs that cannot be invaded by code in other parts of a program. Next one is software complexity can be easily managed. It means software complexity is a way to describe a specific set of characteristics of your code. Characteristics means data of your code. These characteristics all focus on how your code interacts with other pieces of code. The measurement of these characteristics is what determines the complexity of your code. So these are all the advantages of object-oriented programming language. Now let's see the disadvantages of object-oriented programming language. Classes tend to be overgeneralized. Next one is relation among classes becomes artificial at times. And then object-oriented programs design is tricky. And one needs to do proper planning and proper design for OOP programming. Programmer need proper skills such as design skills, programming skills and thinking skills. So these are all the disadvantages of object-oriented programming language. Now it's time to end this session. In this video, you learn about data abstraction. Data abstraction is the act of representing the essential features without knowing the background details. And you learned about encapsulation. And you learned about inheritance. What is inheritance? The term inheritance means to link and share some common properties of one class with the another class. This can be done by extending the object of one class into another class and using through it. And you learned about polymorphism. The term polymorphism defines as the process of using a function or method for more than one purpose. At last, you learned about advantages and disadvantages of object-oriented programming language. Greetings to you children, because we completed lesson 1. Now let's see some recapitulation questions from this video. What do you understand by the term data abstraction? Data abstraction is the act of representing the essential features without knowing the background details. You have to write your own example what you understood in this video. What is inheritance? The term inheritance means to link and share some common properties of one class with the other class. This can be done by extending the object of one class into another class and using through it. Here also you have to write the example. And third question is, define encapsulation. The system of wrapping data and functions into a single unit is known as encapsulation. You have to write the example. What is polymorphism? The term polymorphism defines as the process of using a function or method for more than one purpose. Here also you have to write the example what you understood in this video. And write advantages and disadvantages of OOP. You have to copy down these 5 question answers. 1, 2, 3, 4 and this one, 5th one. You have to copy down all 5 question answers in your practice note and take the photocopy of your practice note and submit in the Google Classroom. Use the class code UY64EZIG. This time many of them submitted their classwork and home test on time. I really appreciate your hard work. Good children. Here I attached the names those who are submitted their classwork and home test on time. Okay, many of them submitted their classwork but they didn't submit their home test. I give you more in some time. you have to submit before Tuesday your home test. Okay, this is the marks for class work, this is the marks for home test. Here I have some incomplete names also. I can see some new students' name. New students, if you have any doubt regarding online classes or home test or classwork submission, you can contact me. I am ready to help you. I am your class teacher, Charles Velangani. Then I can see some old students' names also. You also didn't submit all three assignments. Children, I give you 1 week time. Before Tuesday, you have to submit all three assignments together in the Google Classroom. You should submit. Okay, children, you have please be prompt in your work. Avoid late submission. Thank you, students.